Sometimes, if you want to make progress, you gotta learn not to sweat the small stuff. After Adelard introduced the elements back into Western Europe in the 12th century, it rapidly became all the rage with the 0.1% of people who could, you know, read. Soon, these happy, literate few were doing all the things you do with books, namely illuminating them, to copies of Euclid. Then, at around 1450, Western Europe figured out this cool thing called printing, and it was off to the races. Page-turner that it was, the elements rapidly became the second most printed thing after the Bible. Fast forward to a little over a century later, and a fellow in England does this painstaking retranslation of the elements, providing the world with a more accurate version, and the first printed version in English. Perhaps more importantly, though, the great mathematician and imperialist John Dee, who, fun fact, was also a wizard, wrote an extensive preface to the text, explaining it in detail so that even without a university education, people of the emerging merchant and trade classes could understand the beauty of its logic. And you know what's even cooler? When you got to the section on three-dimensional shapes, it became a pop-up book. How rad is that for 16th century printing technology? So now, with its cool whiz-bang 3D technology, Euclid became the mathematics of choice for people with access to absolutely no other mathematics. This became huge for England, as there are some jobs, like getting a ship across an ocean, which it'd be really nice if somebody knew some mathematics for. And the growing pool of people who could understand Euclid meant that there was a growing pool of people who could do those jobs. Which brings us to one of my favorite French philosopher mercenaries, René Descartes. He is going to build off of Euclid to create, or at least get credit for creating, the first system that thinks about geometry in a different way. But Descartes' path to getting there isn't all that simple. You see, he was born into the working nobility, that sort of minor nobility that confused all of Europe during the 16th and 17th century. They were people who got rich enough to buy some land, but not so rich that they could just live off of it. This low-level subclass of nobility baffled the lingering medieval understanding of the world, so they usually ended up with some minor title thrown at them just so the truly wealthy folks could make sense of them. Descartes' family, in that vein, was a family of doctors and lawyers, and he himself was sent off to get an education so that he might enter the legal profession. He went to a Jesuit school where he was taught rhetoric, philosophy, physics, as it was understood at the time, and of course, mathematics, naturally focusing on Euclid. Then he shuffled off to university to complete his law degree, mostly to satisfy the nagging of his dad. But the instant he was done getting that degree, Descartes declared that he would seek only the education that the world could give him, and he took off looking for adventure. And what more adventurous thing was there to do at the time than to sign up as a mercenary and help the Dutch throw the Spanish out of the Dutch Republic? So he did that. But of course he got there during a period of relative peace, so he was assigned to be a military engineer and was immediately sent to study some more geometry. And while I am sure that this was somewhat frustrating for him, it was kind of a lucky break for the rest of us, because the guy who invented the Dutch system of military engineering was a polymath who was on the cutting edge of physics and mathematics at the time, which meant more math for Descartes to learn. But Descartes soon got bored of all of this not war and legged it over to the Holy Roman Empire to find his next adventure, which was apparently locking himself in a room with little more than a stove. It must have been some room, though, because in it, he simultaneously invented a system of deductive reasoning that would basically be the underpinning of all future science, and developed the Cartesian coordinate system, which was a system used to universally convert algebra problems into geometry and geometry problems into algebra. This incredible work turned out to be a major sea change for both math and science. See, up to this point, much of Western science really just boiled down to interpreting or theorizing from ancient texts. Descartes' proto-scientific method, however, demanded proof. Nothing was to be believed or extrapolated from unless its veracity was undeniable. This philosophy meant that scientists should no longer just accept what they read in Aristotle or Galen, but should instead test it. And if what they read failed the test, they were to discard it and search for better answers. That type of reasoning, coupled with the Cartesian coordinate system, which vastly magnified the power and scope of mathematics, opened the floodgates for the science of the next few centuries. Now that mathematics wasn't limited to only that which could be constructed using a compass and a straight edge, now that it had the tools necessary to analyze any shape or pattern we might find in nature, it was just a matter of time until somebody put it all together in a way that helped us understand our world in a fundamentally mathematical way. Enter a plucky young English fellow named Newton. Where Descartes had used Euclid as the foundation for his system, in much the same way as Al-Khwarizmi had, Newton had a new thought. What if you thought of geometric construction not as static, but as alive? Something that wasn't just a single snapshot image, but ongoing. Something that could be thought of as a process, repeating forever. With this thought, Newton gave us the answer to one of the oldest problems in mathematics. Squaring the circle. You see, Newton wanted to write a book about this neat law of the physical world he'd figured out, called gravity. But in order to deliver a book about the orbits of the planets and the effects of gravity on moving bodies, he was gonna have to deal with a lot of curves and the area that a curve encompasses. And the problem with that is that it was impossible. Mathematicians had been trying since Euclid's time to square the circle, to figure out what the square area of a circle might be. In fact, they had been trying to do that for so long and with so little success that the phrase squaring the circle had worked its way into literature as a sort of shorthand term for confounding oneself with an impossible task. But Newton had a new approach. He knew what to do. He would just have to invent calculus. Yep, this is when, how, and why we get calculus. Although, honestly, there is a whole other series we could do about calculus's origins, and a fellow named Leibniz inventing it simultaneously. Another day, perhaps. So, what is calculus, really? Well, it's actually just an extension of Euclid by people who understood Descartes and needed to figure out how much space was below a curve. So let's do the proposition that Newton used to give the world the fundamental building block of calculus, the integral. First, he sets up a right angle. Next, he draws a curve from the ends of each of the lines in the right angle. Then he says, draw any number of rectangles with the same size base under your curve, so that your top right corner just touches the curve. Now, draw a rectangle from the top of your line segment where you started the curve to the point at which your first rectangle touches the curve. Do the same thing for each other rectangle, starting at the point where the previous rectangle touches the curve. Do all of that, and what do we have? Well, a really blocky approximation of our curve. And you can see that we're off by whatever parts of the second set of rectangles stick out past our curve. So, how do we solve this? Well, so far, this has all been pure Euclid. How he constructed the curve and the rectangles are all things we could have learned from the elements. So Newton is still using Euclid to build up his proposition. But then, he adds his own great insight. He says, try doing the same thing, but make more and thinner rectangles. You see how much less rectangle ends up out over the curve? Well, and hold on to your hats, because here's the kicker, and here's actually how integration works. He says, imagine constructing infinite, infinitesimally thin rectangles. Do that, and the area sticking out above the curve is now zero. Or, put another way, the area of all of these rectangles is equal to the area under the curve. That's it. That's all there really is to the fundamental theorem of calculus. Sure, we've cleaned up the idea a little in the few centuries since then, but that's really it. Integration is just figuring out how many infinitesimally small rectangles fit under a curve. And with that, and with some Cartesian coordinates thrown in to turn it all into algebra, we can now map the physical world to a mathematical space. Thus, with his great work, the Principia, Newton started a revolution in scientific thinking. Soon we were mathematizing everything from atomic movement to the movement of the stars. Physics took enormous leaps forward. 200 years later, we'd split the atom. But so far, everything we've talked about is still fundamentally rooted in Euclid. Algebra? Just an extension of Euclid. Calculus? Really still just an extension of Euclid. But as math rushed forward, people began to think about that postulate 5 again, and what it might mean. What if it was valid, but what if it wasn't the only valid possibility? Join us next time as humanity finally leaps into true non-Euclidean geometry.